Hello, folks. Welcome back. As always, this is Jason James, aka Dusty Westfield, for Polarization Nation Media. This is an original documentary I'm reposting, and I've only lightly edited it to avoid YouTube censorship. Most of the videos and documentaries on Gnosticism contain a lot of disinformation. This is a heavily guarded and gatekept subject. This is one of the best videos I found on the subject, probably why it's been scrubbed off of YouTube. I hope you enjoy it.
Embodiment of divine wisdom.
Jesus of Nazareth, man or myth? Those who walked with him didn't seem to remember him as God's only begotten son. They perished in the Holocaust, which came from the Jewish rising against Rome. Do the Gospels from our Bible paint him as clearly? They were written 2-3 generations after Christ, in cities elsewhere in the Mediterranean, when another image emerged, that of Jesus, the Son of God. But a different memory still lingered. The Middle Ages, the south of France. Briefly and for the last time, a different faith stands up again of Christians with another view of Christ. People the church considers heretics, worse than devils. For decades, the fury of the church raises against these Gnostic Christians. Crusading armies decimate the population. The Inquisition is invented to burn out these Cathars, as they call themselves, those purified, the pure. After many centuries, people now start remembering these Cathars and visit the places where they suffered.
The Cathars were not forerunners of the Reformation. They were not a heresy of the Catholic faith. This was a faith that was completely different and went back to the earliest times of Christianity and even before that. When people experienced this world as a world of shadows, turned with their back towards reality, towards the true world.
Man bound, unable to turn, believing the shadows he sees on the wall in front of him are reality, shadows cast by the real, divine world that goes on behind him. That is how the Greek philosopher Plato described man. Initiates of ancient mystery religions believed they could shed the ropes that bound them and find gnosis, knowledge felt in the heart, secret knowledge that transforms man and makes him become aware of the true spiritual world. They are called Gnostics. Scholars begin to recognize that quest also in earliest Christianity, before our Gospels were written, in the words of Paul, who speaks of finding Christ within, inside yourself. And in other ancient documents, found almost 60 years ago in Nag Hammadi, Egypt.
The books from Nag Hammadi are more important than the Dead Sea Scrolls, because they throw a new light on the history of Christianity, on Jesus, and on God.
The discovery of the Nag Hammadi library by 2 Egyptian peasants brought about a fundamental change in our understanding of early Christianity. Here we had 52 new manuscripts telling us about early Christianity. They were probably associated with Egyptian Christian monastery. Books were buried to evade a book-burning expedition in the middle of the 4th century.
It's just given us a whole wealth of information, and I find it astonishing, really, that the Christians haven't run out everywhere and wanting to read the Gospel of Thomas and all these other marvellous scriptures which have come to light. And I think it says something about how powerful the hold of the Roman Church was, but that it's still pushed outside, they're still regarded as heretical and dangerous. And of course, they are. They are heretical and they are dangerous from the perspective of the literalist church, because they turn the understanding of the literalist church inside out.
They tell us about a variety of ways in which people believe that you could find salvation by contemplating, by expanding the divine spark that's buried in each of us, communicating with God by searching inside one's own soul, an individual pursuit of the divine without the help of priests or bishops.
Sounds attractive.
Gnosticism is amazingly attractive. I think particularly attractive to the modern mind, because it sells a religion for the individual, not a religion brought about by a church. I think it's Urart. I think this is what humans have always looked for, yearned for, to try and find divinity by themselves. But that's to oversimplify, because it is also extraordinarily complicated. In many ways, if you read it, it's like having a bath in a thousand soap bubbles and getting the soap into your eyes. It's blinding, it's obscuring, as well as cleansing.
It was already there in the Egyptian religion when they said that man, after his life, became Osiris. He was integrated into the Godhead. Man is a fallen god that remembers heaven. That is the concept of all mysteries of antiquity, of Isis, of Mithras, of Adonis, everything.
The central point of Gnosticism is that each of us is born with a divine spark inside us, and the duty of the believer is to try to find that divine spark, to get into touch with God by looking inside ourselves. Gnosis means self-knowledge.
What is self-knowledge? Ecstasy? Psychoanalysis? What is it?
It's very difficult to explain what self-knowledge is and how to come by it. It's not like psychoanalysis. It's not an intellectual exploration of the soul. It's not ecstasy. It's quiet contemplation by oneself, sometimes with the help of a leader, of who you are and how God made you, what God is like. It's a quietist. It's a single individual self-searching.
The basic idea that underlies Gnosticism or mysticism is that we're stuck in our ideas about what life is and about who we are. And coming down into an environment like this knocks you out of your ordinary mindset. You're face to face with perhaps the greatest mystery, death, the idea that you will cease to exist as a physical form, and it pushes you out of your ideas into a direct encounter with the absolute mystery from which everything comes, the mystery that we are, the mystery that it is.
But why seek this in this darkness, in these corridors?
I think it triggers the mystical experience with excitement of darkness and light and candles and the echoing chambers. It's all part of putting you into that mystical state. As Aristotle says about the mysteries, you don't go there to learn something, you go there to experience something. If you think of it as just being an intellectual process, you're missing the point. It's something far grander than that. I think the ancients had understood that you can know a lot, but not really have self-knowledge. When we learn something, we are learning many things. It becomes very complex. What the ancients are seeking is a return from the manyness of things, with knowledge about many things, to knowledge of one thing, of the unity of all things.
For most of two millennia, Gnosis was suppressed. We mainly knew about it from the fulminations of church fathers, but the find of Nag Hammadi in 1945 forever changes the way we look upon the origins of Christianity. The men who found it discarded it at first. They fell into the hands of black traders, some were burnt, but eventually it found its way to science, also thanks to Gilles Quispel, who hit upon the most important manuscripts somewhere in Europe and brought it to his friends, the great psychologist Carl Jung. They now gather dust in a small room in Cairo, open maybe once in 10 years and only in the company of an officer of the museums, the police, the secret police, and a judge. Quispel is most welcome. All of the Nag Hammadi manuscripts were published when he gave back the most precious one, the Gospel of Thomas, with the words of Jesus.
It starts with the word, these are the words that Jesus, the living, spoke.
And Didymus Judas Thomas wrote. And he said, whoever finds the explanation of these words will not taste death.
Who was Didymus Judas Thomas?
Didymus Judas Thomas, which means Judas the twin, was one of the brothers of Jesus.
Later church tradition turned Thomas into the apostle who could not believe Jesus came back in the flesh, stigmata and all.
Doubting Thomas, who is now said to be the most faithful disciple of his master.
Who best understood his brother.
According to the Gospel of Thomas, yes.
He's understood not to be Jesus' twin brother on a literal level, but rather that whoever reads this gospel is to understand that he or she can come to recognize himself as Jesus' twin.
What does that Gospel of Thomas say?
Well, the Gospel of Thomas is a collection of sayings which promises to reveal something. What it says it will reveal is what no ear has heard, no eye has seen,
what no hand has touched, and what has never occurred to the human mind.
What is it? Well, it's you. You are the thing you can't hear, see, your essence, consciousness itself. And I think this is the key thing, if you want to understand what Christianity is actually about and what paganism is actually about, is to understand that it's a journey of self-knowledge. And this was the great injunction which the god Apollo gave to the pagans at the Oracle of Delphi, to search for the gnosis, the self-knowledge, know yourself. And the same with the Christians. And what they're looking for is the part of you which cannot die. It's not that you're going to be granted something you don't already have. It's discovering that you are already immortal, because your essence, so all human beings are images, or the word they use is eidolon. They are an image of the one daemon or spirit.
A reflection of the divine.
Not a reflection so much as the divine become conscious of itself. Become conscious. They use the term for the father of the dazzling darkness. If you imagine light with nothing to reflect on, it's dark. So light in itself is dark, and they use this term dazzling darkness. Pure potentiality. Just light, just consciousness, with nothing to be conscious of. when that creates for itself something to be conscious of, or something, or as light, something to reflect on, the universe comes into being. Out of this one consciousness of God expresses itself in all conscious beings. So all of us are images, are dolons of the one consciousness of the that is the universe, that is everything, which is God.
Christian myth as we have it, on the contrary, emphasizes a deep gulf between man and God. God is God, and we are mere mortals.
Now, the Gospel of Thomas has a very different message. It speaks of Jesus as Son of God, and speaks of all other humans as also the children of God, who may not be aware of that because they are not aware of being created in the image of God, the divine light that came into being before the universe was created, when God said, "Let there be light." Humankind was made in the image of that light. And in the Gospel of Thomas, Jesus speaks as the voice from the light.
Why are the words from Thomas' Gospel, "Look under any stone and you shall find me," so dangerous for the church?
Well, I think it's because it's pantheistic. It is suggesting that divinity is everywhere and in all things. What happens with the Christian triumph is, well, you know, what you would expect in the creation of a church. In order to get to God, you have to go through the bishop. You know, if you want to build a church, you have to say that no, salvation is only possible by, with, from, and through the church and God's representative on earth, who is the Pope. And that is the only way. Whereas the Gnostics are very much, it's about you, you can do it.
This was the revelation of the Gnosis, was that your essence, by its very nature, is immortal. So you didn't have to win it by being a good boy, by obeying the rules. This is why the Gnostics are quite anarchistic. They're free thinkers, they're libertines, they don't go for obeying rules. And of course their great hero, Jesus, is portrayed in their story as a libertine who hangs out with prostitutes and hangs out with disreputable people. Breaks the rules, he does the wrong thing on the Sabbath, and who constantly attacks the religious authorities and is in dispute with them. He's a classic Gnostic character, and they were like that themselves. Because of this, because for them it's not about being obeying rules. For them it's about discovering self-knowledge, what you really are.
In Thomas, the message is more important than the messenger. It stems from a time before the Gospels of the Bible, as does a man long considered a founder of the faith, but now beginning to be seen in a different light, Paul.
Paul is a Gnostic. He is talking about the Christ within. He's talking about immortality and the mystery school teaching, because Paul is existing before the literal story.
Paul is a completely misconceived character in history. At the time of Paul, we would say that there is no split between Gnosticism and literalism, because literalism hasn't developed. There is no literal Jesus at this time.
One, two generations later, the Gospels of the Bible recount the life of Jesus in detail. The messenger becomes almost more important than the message, and Jesus comes to be the literal Son of God. But before that, Paul, under layers of later adaptations and insertions, still talks of Jesus as a mystery, a metaphor, a voice within.
Gnostic Christians believed that Paul was their teacher. The father of the church, Tertullian, who despised Gnostics, nevertheless called Paul the apostle to the heretics, because the heretics, he thought, love Paul. They all quote Paul. They all claim Paul, because his teaching is so mysterious, in some ways so deep.
It is the God of the Old Testament, of an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, a jealous God.
All their stories seem to revolve around a deep dissatisfaction with the present world, because it was created by an inferior god. How could a perfect god have created this mess? So the story they tell repeatedly is how that this world is a mistake. It's created because gods, the true gods, youngest daughter, wisdom, girl, Sophia, fell madly in love with her father. And out of the frustration of this illicit love, she self-created. She impregnated herself. And the misbegotten child inside her, she aborted. And this aborted, misshapen, lion-faced son, Yaldabaoth, the king of kings, out of an arrogant supposition that he was once ejected from heaven for sole god, created or miscreated this world, this physical world. So this world was created out of an illicit passion in grief by Yaldabaoth, whom Jews and Christians falsely worship as the true god.
This god imprisoned man in matter, wrapped his divine eternal soul in a body which was mortal. Creator of this physical world, he created man in his image, forever slave to matter, trying to accumulate more and more.
The good God, the true God, out of the kindness of his mercy, sent Jesus to redeem humanity from the mistaken ideas of Yaldabaoth.
When these Jews of Alexandria had become Christians, Jesus appealed to their deepest selves. They said, "Who knows himself knows God."
Whether man, myth or metaphor, in the figure of Jesus lay also the seed of dissent. Around his person, a battle of ideas ensued that would drive the two views apart.
Certainly, one of the greatest struggles that the followers of Jesus had to contend with was the question of why Jesus died in the dreadful way that he did. And in these Orthodox communities, the only way they could make religious sense out of it is to speak of it as an atonement sacrifice. But it could only be important as an atonement sacrifice if everyone needed atonement for sin. So Christians developed the idea that everyone must have sinned dreadfully beyond the capacity of making any atonement of any kind, and therefore that God's own Messiah died as an atonement sacrifice for the sin of the world became a very compelling way of understanding his crucifixion.
It brought a crucial new element into the relationship between man and the divine, sin.
The central element in the Christian message, its lever, is the degree to which it instills guilt, that God is there watching, knowing not only what we do, but what we think. I think Christianity is quite exceptional in the degree to which the all-seeing God observes and punishes, is said to punish, believers for faults of thought, for sins of the mind.
Sin and guilt gave rise to a creed in which hell became imaginable, fear of God, and admonishments of priests. It was not an idea the Gnostics wished to share.
The word sinner doesn't figure in their dictionary.
The Gospel of Thomas speaks not so much of the discontinuity between God and ourselves, but of humans created in the divine image, and therefore having a sort of innate connectedness, affinity with the divine.
Man is a fallen God that remembers heaven. That is the concept of all mysteries of antiquity and also of Gnosis. The word sin doesn't find a place.
That doesn't mean, of course, that we're sinless or divine, but rather that we can find our way to God when we find our way to ourselves. And for what sins we commit or what wrongs we do, there are means of redress.
But to make sin so essential that Jesus had to die to redeem us, argument focused on an ancient myth, Adam and Eve, and the first sin which made man mortal.
Christians dwell upon the sinfulness of Eve, the wicked woman, much more than Jews do.
Before Orthodox Christianity, sin hadn't been such an issue. Jewish rabbis, pagans, Gnostic teachers basically agreed that we have in us the capacity to follow or to disobey God.
We have the good impulse and the evil impulse. And that was understood to be a human condition.
There's a great debate about it, because some Christians thought it was crazy. This is eating an apple, one minor disobedience, and for that millennia of Christians are condemned by God to an inferior existence rather than living in paradise. It's a completely disproportionate punishment.
Only in later Christianity, that idea of inherent human sinfulness, original sin, develops, especially by Augustine, in the 4th century. So in these Orthodox communities, one develops a strong sense not only of the distance between God and humankind, but of the innate and irredeemable sinfulness of the human condition, apart from this death of Christ now understood as sacrifice.
But the conventional Christianity, the canonical Christianity, which didn't become established until the 2nd century, was much disputed. And so some Christians thought that Jesus was a divine figure and that it was completely inappropriate for him to have suffered on the cross. And they told stories which justified their beliefs. For example, when Jesus was being brought up to Golgotha after being flogged, and was obviously weak from the flogging, the soldiers got Simon of Cyrene to carry his cross. And Jesus, seeing this as a perfect opportunity, swapped identities with Simon of Cyrene, so that it was Simon looking like Jesus who was crucified, while Jesus, looking like Simon, slunk off in the crowd, went up to heaven, and hovered above the cross, laughing at the success of his deception. Or laughing as a Buddha is laughing, smiling, passively, because of the calm and peace that Jesus has from knowing and from illuminating us, giving us his knowledge.
Jesus, an illuminator, the voice, the symbol of the divine. And Gnostics saw Jesus as the man who received divine insight at baptism when he became like a Buddha, he who knows, the Christ. Orthodox Christians took it literally. If Jesus was divine, he was God's son, his only begotten son. He also had to be born divine, which Gnostics considered a childish, naive notion. The split becomes apparent with the latest gospel in the Bible, John.
Many Christians today will think, well, of course, Christianity means Jesus is the Son of God. But that's not what you find in Matthew, Mark, or Luke so much. You find in those the teaching that Jesus is God's Messiah, the one who redeems his people, the one who teaches the way of righteousness. One could be a very devout Jew and follow Jesus at that point. But with the Gospel of John, the claim that Jesus is God's Son, and more than that, his only Son, that radical claim, which actually I cannot find mentioned among Orthodox Christians before about the year 160, becomes the lens through which Christians later read all the Gospels. I began to be convinced, it sounds bizarre, that the Gospel of John was written to counter this other view. And it changes the understanding of the Christian message in a dramatic way.
Jesus, the literal Son of God and only begotten one. But to Gnostics, Jesus was a metaphor, a symbol for the divine that hides in all of us. In that sense, we are all sons of God.
We are all sons of God if we realize our true identity. Whilst we don't, we are in a state of death. Now, this is fascinating, I think. In the ancient world, this is the underworld. We now are dead. For the Gnostics, for the mystics, this is the underworld in which we are the spiritually dead, because we think we're the body, and we're not. We are God, if you like. We are the one consciousness of the universe. We mistake ourselves as these individual bodies with all of the problems that come with that. What we need to do is we need to resurrect. And the whole of the story is we need to die to the identity of the body, which is on the cross of matter, and we need to resurrect to our true identity, which is the Son of God, which is the Christ, the consciousness of the Father. So we are all Christ, and we all need to resurrect.
And in that sense, the whole myth, the whole story of the crucifixion of Christ and the resurrection is a model to all and each of us.
Yes, precisely. It's a model which can take you through this initiation. But again, this difference. With the literalist Christians, very quickly this becomes the rather macabre idea that at the end of time, somehow you will resurrect into your body and will be a physical body again. Because that's what they think happened to Jesus. It's a natural curve. He came back in his physical body, having died literally, and that's literally what will happen to you. Or if it will happen to you if you understand the Christian message. The Gnostics, of course, are saying the complete opposite. If you don't understand the Christian message, you will come back into a body through reincarnation. If you do understand the Christian message, you will realize that you are not the body in the first place, but you are the Christ. We are all one, and there will be no need to go through this circle of reincarnation.
Almost a different faith, an opposite approach. Which came first? Which was the origin?
We have the literalist Christian Polycarp. A few decades later, in the middle of the second century, we have Tertullian saying that the followers of the Gnostics fill the universe. So you get this idea, actually, rather than this literalist church, which is the traditional picture, of course, that the literalist church followed from the apostles, Peter and all those characters, and that the Gnostics were a much later deviation that kind of went pagan. What we're suggesting is actually it's completely the other way around. Gnostic Christianity was widespread in the first and second centuries and was crushed by a literalist church which turned on its origin.
Orthodoxy, as we know it, arose after Gnosticism, and to a large extent Orthodoxy was a reaction. It defined itself by what it is not. Christianity defines itself by what it opposes. By opposing Gnosticism, it gradually defined its own terms.
From a wide variety of dozens of Gospels and writings, and seven or eight generations after Jesus lived, early Orthodox Church Fathers began selecting the few which would shape the New Testament and define the creed.
I think it's in the face of terrible danger, the threat of persecution that impelled concerned Christian leaders to try to find the basic teachings on which they felt all could agree.
In this selection, overt Gnostic views, elements too complicating for a literalist view of Jesus, were laid aside.
In the figure of Jesus, for instance, we get that the phrase which is plastered over more churches, I expect, than any other phrase, which no one comes to the Father but by me, which in the hands of Gnostics is the teaching that to come to God you have to go through what this figure represents in you. And this is Paul's message. To come to God you have to find the Christ within as an allegory of truth. But it's literalism which goes, no, this is the only way. And I think once you have this idea of a literal incarnation of the Son of God, not a mythic incarnation of the Son of God, then the correlate of that is that for their own good, you must save the souls of others, and everyone must be led to believe this, or forced to believe this indeed, for their own good. So you get a divine injunction to be authoritarian.
the debate was very peculiar. Christians took everything personally, because that is the nature of Christianity. But when you personalize divinity, you bring to divinity all the anger, judgments, resentment, and aggression that exists in human personality.
Heretic!
Christians got violently upset because they took it personally that their Savior was being denied. Gnostics just wanted to find out what was the truth.
The difficulty Gnostics face is that because they are individually searching for salvation by themselves, they're not organized. They're not united.
Gnostics, they attacked the views of the early Christians. The Christians did not simply attack the views of the Gnostics in return. They attacked the Gnostics themselves.
Both views might still have existed side by side, but for the appearance of this man, Constantine, first Roman emperor to embrace Christianity, in whose wake the young church reaches for power supreme.
The story goes that Constantine had a vision, a dream, in which he saw the sign of the cross in the sky, and he was convinced that if he became a Christian and used this emblem for his troops, he would win a battle against his rival pagan emperor. It's here at the Milvian Bridge that a great battle was fought, which started Christianity on its triumphant road to success.
The Council of Nicaea, 324. Emperor Constantine settles all differences about the creed.
Fellow ministers, we believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, God from God.
Three centuries after he lived, Jesus is proclaimed to be the Son of God by imperial decree. All other opinions are forbidden.
When Christianity allies with the state to create a religious monopoly, that's when Christianity becomes radically different. One would say triumphant, successful, but for the fact that once the church is allied with the state, it begins to commit the very crimes that it has complained about for the first 300 years of its existence. It persecutes. It kills for religion. It has to become a hierarchical, oppressive institution. Of course, you could defend it and say it's in the interests of the masses that a particular brand of religion is forced on them. But it's not my fantasy, my imagination of how religion best proceeds.
It's interesting, isn't it, that soon after his conversion, the Emperor Constantine gave glorious gifts to the churches at Rome, St. Peter's and St. John Lateran here, solid life-size statues of Jesus and the apostles, so that soon Christian churches looked exactly like pagan temples.
And this is merely one straw in the wind of the wealth that the church acquires throughout the fourth century. Is the church corrupted? Yes. Does it preserve a sense of its origins, the sense of the importance of poverty? Yes. So the church is split between the poverty and abstinence of the monks and the wealth of the bishops. But even then, the bishops maintain a sense, a memory of charity, of virtue, the best of them. So it's always torn, it always has this tension inside it.
Jesus, whatever else he did not set up a church, left no instructions for a church.
It's a later fiction designed to bolster the power of the Catholic Church. It's simply inconceivable that Jesus, a simple man from Galilee, set out to found a universal church.
What happened with Jesus handing over authority to Peter?
Well, again, these legends are so fictitious that they didn't make it into the New Testament, like the donation of Constantine.
The donation of Constantine is a fake.
This was a document which was claimed by the Roman Church in the medieval period to be the contract written out by Constantine on his deathbed. Here, I give you the empire for safekeeping. Now, when this was revealed to be a forgery, this started the whole Protestant Reformation.
In some ways, all that Peter and I have done is listen to the losers. They were destroyed in the 4th century. We've gone back and said, well, just because they lost that battle, just because the Roman Church, with its idea of an historical Jesus and a literalist religion, took over, doesn't mean that they've got the accurate version of events.
What happened to the losers?
Well, they were eradicated. Everybody who knew the different story, which is the Gnostics, the pagans, were banished from the empire. The temples were pulled down. The philosophers were killed, were banished, the books were burned. I mean, if Christianity was God's favourite religion, then you would have thought when it triumphed, we would have entered a golden age. But instead, we entered the Dark Ages, when people forgot even how to make brick houses. And we had to wait until the Renaissance, when all this pagan learning came back in Italy, in Florence. The books of Plato, which had been banished for 1,000 years, came back. The Hermetica, and suddenly Botticelli was painting pictures of pagan gods, and we call it the rebirth of Western culture, because this is when we got back to the place we had been before Christianity triumphed.
Belief in the Jesus story was originally only a first step in Christian spirituality, the outer mystery. The significance was to be explained by an enlightened teacher when the student was spiritually ripe, a mystical knowledge of God beyond mere dogma.
Although there are many great Christian mystics of later centuries who have intuitively seen through to this deeper symbolic level, as a culture, we've kept only the outer mysteries. It seems to me we have kept the form, but we have lost the meaning.
As churches become empty, people seek elsewhere, sometimes as far as the other side of the world, not realizing an ancient tradition which sought the same lies deep within our past and addresses similar people.
Certain fathers of the church, like Irenaeus in his famous 5 volumes against the heretics, are attempts to identify Gnostics and say they're really not Christians, they're heretics. They have special characteristics. First of all, they love to read and interpret scripture. Second, they look to their own intuitions, revelations, and dreams and believe that they are receiving intimations about the divine. Third, they are constantly seeking. They're continually open to new exploration. Now, one could have said the same about people that are called New Age, but certainly philosophers were expected to inquire and keep asking.
Asking, one finds a tradition eradicated, interrupted for many, many centuries, complicated for us today, sometimes bewildering.
All of this is pretty difficult to comprehend for Mother Man.
Dear friend, there is no shortcut to Gnosis and no instant nirvana.
He made me laugh with that, the old gentleman. And he was right, of course.
Every great world religious tradition, whether it's Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, Judaism, has both the teaching for everyone, exoteric teaching, which every adherent of that faith is supposed to follow, and esoteric or mystical teaching. The only one that lacks that, in a way, is Western Christianity. I think it's unfortunate that that path, which many people find necessary for their own integrity and development, has been regarded as either heretical or a path leading nowhere.